Thank you for such a generous introduction. Listening to this, I started to think of myself as the very object of my own work, the monument. So what I can do here to demonumentalize myself a little bit by sharing with you some aspects of my the process of creating my work. But what's important is that we are here in City Hall, which I like very much, more than kind of university lecture halls, because it is a place that has all to do with democracy, with the city, with polis. Also, I'm very glad to be here because it's a place where the equipment that I'm using for years is being created and produced. It's a place of media technology, communication technology. So I was very happy to actually see the place where those projectors that I've been using for years are being produced, and also to see how far actually advanced the researchers in that place that inspired some of my ideas. And so I'm very grateful to be here. Also, I'm very close to the place where I began my Canadian, North American journey, starting with Canada, University of Guelph, but also in Toronto, Ontario College of Art, and Peterborough, Ontario, Trent University, where I was teaching history and theory of the avant-garde courses as a part of cultural studies program, which was at that time actually the only program of this kind. So this is a kind of avant-garde beginning. Also, my first projections actually happened in Toronto in 1980-81, before I continue working on them in Halifax, in Nova Scotia. So this biography is actually the first time I'm starting my presentation with biography. But also this this place actually demands some few thoughts about democracy and democratic process. As it was already introduce here this issue with city and as a communicative environment. I'd like to focus on my presentation mostly on the works that develop after I began working in the United States because of a dramatic situation that I was forced to face, moving from maybe more kind of together, working together, welfare democratic situation in Canada. So the kind of jungle of New York City during the time of maybe one of the worst periods in the post-war history of New York City, the time of Reagan, where actually, which later followed by Margaret Thatcher in Britain, the kind of destruction of basically a social base, in specifically the halfway institutions for people who lost the ground, the economical base, and also destruction of single room occupancy hotels, which was a very important last resort for mostly homeless men in New York City. Basically throwing into the streets, many people from mental institutions. So it actually was 100,000 homeless people in New York City when I arrived in the early 80s. In this situation, actually very much educated by cultural studies methodologies and prepared to see United States in a proper critical framework, thanks to my friends with whom I was closely associated, I realized that as an industrial designer, which is my original identity, I was working in this field in Poland for many years, educated in the tradition of systematic design, of Ulm School of Design at that time, very kind of based on radical functionalism. I realized that this kind of industrial design blood circulating in my veins animated my spirit, and I started thinking, well, I should be doing something in face of this massive presence of homeless people. Of course, I was very naive, like most of industrial designers or designers, period, and they see the situation, they jump into this. So I presented various ideas to homeless people of various vehicle designs, and it was based on kind of minimal space. I don't want to even show those sketches, embarrassing. But they seem to be very good because they were providing protection for homeless people, privacy. They started to laugh at me. Man, this is not a privacy issue. This is a security issue. If you want us to hide in some shells, the garbage truck backing up 5 o'clock in the morning when it's dark in the winter will crush us. No one will see us. So our belongings also need to be seen because we have to protect them from being stolen by others. So eventually it became clear that I have to redesign this vehicle with the help of my consultants. So of course the result is what you see here of this model that allowed for both collecting for the purpose to resell bottles, cans from plastic, metal, and glass for very meager income, just maybe enough, maybe to be able to find somewhere whatever was left of those little cheap hotels when it's really cold. But in general, this was the starting point. But then, of course, I realized what I am here doing is not what I intended to do initially, because, of course, it's not the solution. This is not the solution. It's something else going on here. It's an emergency help combined with articulation of the needs that should not exist in civilized world. So the vehicle function, it was much larger than initially I thought. It actually, its functioning, I thought, should lead to the kind of new consciousness. It's the articulation of the needs that should not exist, should help people to realize that those needs really should not exist, to articulate them and transport them in through various social strata, across various boundaries of the city. And this way, maybe create a kind of scandalous appearance. Articulation of things that is supposed not exist, it should not be a design objective. So I started to think maybe it's a kind of scandalizing functionalism, this type of method of design. For example, one could imagine, one could ask, okay, why should we actually design bandages? There should be no wounds. There should be no emergency wards, but unfortunately they exist. Okay, so why don't we design a bandage that will help to heal the wound, but at the same time reveal the conditions under which the wound happened and point to the actual unacceptability of the situation. Well, so the vehicle started to function actually in a way that was that went beyond my intentions. I'm bringing those issues up because I think that it really inspired my future projects. Its actually unintended function points to its insufficiency. Something that was missing in this vehicle that I wanted to compensate for with projects developed later. And this deficiency is a result of accumulative function. For example, those homeless people who were operating this vehicle, they were not only operators, but also performers. They had to respond to avalanche of questions. Why is this vehicle designed this way? What's the function of this part and the part? How many of them are going to be produced? How much would it cost? And eventually, of course, the question was, actually, how has it happened that you became homeless? Pointed to the operator. Operator becomes a performer. It starts responding, articulating his point of view. He's seeing the city from the point of view of the wound, from the point of view of the bottom perspective, bottom up. Okay, the one who remembers time when he was not or she was not homeless and how it happened. So this kind of memory and experience that was transmitted in a process of encounter between operators, performers, and the public needed another equipment, another kind of technical, communicative substance, which was missing in this project. But still, it worked somehow. I'm not saying that it didn't work. It did work as a communication vehicle. And this work, and in fact, it was a special kind of account set up for people to give money for this project. So the objective was to actually take over some chunks of the city by encampments of those new vehicles, and also create a workshop for the homeless and with the homeless and between non-homeless and homeless to actually invent different kind of vehicles. I was in fact invited to run the homeless vehicle workshop in newly developing homeless cultural center, which was in one of the abandoned buildings in New York City. But unfortunately, this building was attacked by police. Belongings were thrown on the street, the homeless were left, then the building was retaken by homeless people with the help of lawyers. So in fact, it became illegal what city did, but eventually those homeless people never came back. So this plan didn't work. Something else happened. The vehicle didn't do this, but because it appeared in various parts of the city of New York and Philadelphia, and it was on the news, it was in every possible media, including Wall Street Journal. It was engraved, you know, like when they have those articles of important issues, it was engraved precisely and smashed completely as absolute nonsense, but a kind of large article. And there were also articles in some Tikkun or various journals and magazines, and also on television there was a special program in Philadelphia. So in fact, the vehicle was mass not produced but reproduced, and it really contributed to scandalizing the scandal. That is, finding a kind of visual, became a visual vehicle articulating all those problems. So it's like an icon. For a while, it functioned as an icon, which really helped to really further. So to make it finally shorter, I think the utopia of this vehicle is based on the hope that its function will make it obsolete, that it will eventually create enough consciousness so the vehicle will be not necessary because other things will happen. Well, that's obviously a utopia. It didn't really happen. But I feel that something was, the vehicle was used by various people to really articulate the problem. And in fact, the situation got a little better, not because of my project, but I feel that there was some kind of intervention here that I like to have some sound. This is another model, this is a light model. But you see, this person is thinking that it's maybe for her. Once something like this is presented on the street, people might think it's for them. It becomes very clear that it's not, once he explains the function. But she also thought it might be good for her husband.
This is a chair. Let's pull this out and put a bag in it. It's like a small bag. This is the handle that actually comes up. You put your luggage in here. Put your valuables.
So it's a kind of uncanny situation, something that is made of elements that are familiar, like a shopping cart, and that becomes strange. So the operators became no longer perceived as those who are stealing shopping carts, this kind of scavengers, but legitimate operators of the specially designed vehicles. People who work day and night, in fact, contribute to recycling. In fact, in that time in New York, there was a bottle bill of rights. The bottle had a right to be resold for a certain amount of money. It was written by May Koch. He actually put those bill of rights. But homeless people didn't have this kind of bill of rights. So, in fact, attaching yourself to something that is highly legitimate and it's legal, it's actually encouraged by the city, it was difficult for police and for other forces to act against this vehicle. You know, you wanted to have recycling, so you have one. You know, well, if someone is tired and wants to rest, working on helping environment to be clean, what's wrong with that? So this is one of the kind of aspects of this project. So in this moment, I have to. Let's go back to my biography. I ended up actually teaching in Paris, of all places, in 1991. And that was the time of an explosion of European xenophobia. It was the first Le Pen. It also kind of right-wing parties in Belgium, in Holland. It just started to really grow. Attack on immigrants. Of course, unfortunately, this is the third wave of xenophobia today. since that time. So it doesn't end, it just goes back and recycles itself. Well, what you see here, the person on the left is turning his gaze away from the couple on the right. Well, their gaze is directed against his face. Of course, he is being deported by their gaze. He's absolutely vulnerable. He has nothing in between him and them. Of course, why are they going to attacking him with their gaze? Because they're afraid of him. Why are they afraid of him? Because there is something in him or about him that resembles what's inside of them, which they refuse to acknowledge, and they repressed over years of their kind of process of becoming themselves versus the others. You know, they connect this idea of a collective identity based on elimination of strangeness, being with some ideological glue, nationalism and some other forms of gluing people together. You know, they at the same time eliminated everything that would make them feeling different. So they are the same versus the others who are different. Or they are familiar and the others are unfamiliar. So this kind of situation, it's very difficult to break. The initiative has to come from the person on the left. He has to come with unsolicited opening and with some performative way to share his point of view and his create his identity, someone who can actually not only entertain but also instruct, as Brecht would like. So something has to be designed here for him to help to open up with unsolicited act of speech and help those people on the right to come closer without fear. So the artifice has to be created. That is both communicative artifice and transitional object, as psychologist Winnicott would call it. Meaning developmental, so developmental aspects in it. So I started to design various, naively, of course, but consciously relying on the cliché of wonder of the wanderer, of someone who has this walking stick, that is equipped with video and with speaker, and also as a kind of history of the owner's displacement. Exposed, but in symbolic way, of course. That will demand of various questions on the part of people, what's inside, why you put it there, and also listening at this walking stick that will become a stranger's double, meaning something that is even stranger, like estranging estrangement, like displacing displacement, alienating alienation. So bizarre object. So equipped with this, the stranger could definitely suggest some perspective, some point of view. And also maybe create conditions for the non-strangers to start getting closer and recognize actually the history, memory, and also the perspective that has come from the stranger, because the stranger actually is a kind of prophetic figure. Stranger is denouncing and announcing. It's questioning both the place from which it's coming and the place to which it's arriving. It's a philosopher. It's a prophet because it's actually is announcing maybe functional prophet, not the big prophet, but the one who operates as if he or she was a prophet. The functional prophet also can become functional kind of paresiastes, the figure from ancient Greece, the kind of animator of democratic process, the truth teller, someone who tells the truth, disrupts the routine perception and operation of life with pointing to something that must be addressed because I, as an immigrant, as a stranger, my utopia is based on not like utopia, mean no place, utopos, but no place. I refuse to accept this place because of the way I'm being treated, because of my experience, which is in the name of myself, my children, and everybody. Because democracy is being measured by the relation to strangers. Sodom and Gomorrah were destroyed because inhabitants were mistreating the strangers. So this way, utopia is a kind of no place or so-called good place that one has to question. What you give me your home, but for me is a labyrinth, strangers say. So, of course, you're asking me all sorts of questions, very generous questions, such as, you know, where are you from? Where are you from? Well, excuse me, it's a very generous question. Of course, it sounds very good, but it insults me. Because why is it that I have to walk in your mind as a work of geography? Why don't you ask me what I'm doing? What's exactly that I do that contributes to everybody around? I don't want to be deported this way. Also, how do you know that I'm of one particular place? Why don't you ask me, where are you from? Also, those kind of things could be recorded over a longer time period and inscribed into those equipments. So whatever is so difficult to say can be also recorded and all of the things said. So the immigrant doesn't have to really work. It's always too late to say the truth. The truth is already there. So once it's there, the operator can have various relation to it. You know, what this stick is saying is not totally truth. There is something else to it, right? So it becomes this walking stick becomes the center of the community. The new community is formed around the stranger and this equipment. The new discourse is created. One person comes and there's another person. What are you talking about, the two? Actually, three of you. You know, the immigrant, the walking stick, and somebody else, interlocutor. So you have to take a larger perspective. What are you talking about? It's about social contrast. How about the whole process of giving rights to people? It has to be step by step. You know, all of those things. So the political philosophy develops, the sense of community develops. The stranger can become the someone who actually is giving a birth to community, of discourse, of questioning, the kind of community of agonistic democracy, as Chantal Mouffe would like, or Rancière, the kind of discursive idea. Well, of course, the stranger can be equipped with kind of other things that will refer to the stranger's status as a cyborg. Because someone cyborg is not just simply a mixture of artificial and natural parts. It's actually a kind of situation in which cyborg can shift fluently from natural to artificial back and forth. So in that sense, perhaps equipment that is referring to deprivation of speech, like a gag, can also become a megaphone, an extremely baroque, sophisticated speaking device. Of course, if you could go to immigration department wearing this kind of, I would call it cultural prosthetics, you could call it. Because you have cultural rights, so if you have problems with speech, you know, you should be able to go to any office, any place with special equipment. Of course, if this is not that easy, the person will probably be kicked out from immigration office immediately, because there is no immigration office. All of those offices, anti-immigration offices, let's face it. There's no such place. Are we welcoming strangers, giving him documents? And, no. It's not that easy. I have several passports, and it took some being very privileged immigrant. I went through the whole process. So. So she's from Ethiopia, in Helsinki, came with children, no husband, speaks fluently many languages. Most immigrants are polyglots, they speak many languages. she also speaks Russian fluently, because it's very good to speak Russian in Finland. You know, it helps a lot. In many ways, so. So those are the questions, gestures, pointed to those precious immigrant relics. Why did you put it there? What is it? Okay, so there's a whole story around each of those relics. There could be documents, memorabilia, but also the answer could be, it's none of your business. You know, I have to have it. It's necessary for me to carry it. Or I won't talk about this now, because I don't feel like. So those are important gestures. None of this will happen, believe me. It's Stockholm, actually, right now. We are in Stockholm. Without equipment like this. And without the whole process of recording, re-recording, discussing what to say, where are those relics, which one I should put into those containers, because I cannot find them. Because they are dispersed in the entire city. I'm hidden here and there, I don't know where they are. So all of that process of recollection of one's experience and articulation, finding words for unspeakable traumatic events. Displacement is something to do with trauma, of course, in most of the cases. So, here there is one of those operators, performers, is speaking about something very important. The most precious thing in human life is time. And time is being stolen from those people. They wait, for example, for years for their documents to be processed, right? They cannot work. So he's talking about this.
Some symbols are T.
T. I think that means time in Swedish. And he also, of course, being approached by, could speak a lot. About this. So there's also this thing about, like, there's another question. The two of you, where are you from? It's very typical in Stockholm. The two of you, meaning the two black people, right? I said, what do you mean? You know, between the places, like the whole world. I'm from one side of Africa, he's from another side. I speak six languages, he speaks 8 languages, and we share only 3. So, what it means, the two of you are you from? You know, what is it? So that's also good when there's a more collective use.
James.
So this equipment could be developed further. It was maybe now when I visited Christy, we had a discussion about various options that new technology offers. But what's important is that what Julia Kristeva said about strangers, they have Baroque personality. So they speak with accents, with gestures, with this. They have a performative quality. If those who really manage to survive, I mean, the best survivors are the ones who are best equipped with performative talents, of course. So it could be an interesting way to develop new type of speech with the use of, like you see, the kind of Baroque speech.
What is it for?
Oh, it could have also the equipment that is like this one. You pre-record two of yourself in continuing dialogue and dispute, because strangers are in the process of becoming non-strangers. They cross many boundaries inside of themselves. You have a multiplicity of various identities, not personalities, identities. So they are in, So why not pre-record those disputes and let them to be triggered by certain words with the use of speech recognition software. So this one actually had a kind of capacity to open up in an angelic way and close and respond, be hypersensitive. So be hypersensitive, for example, where are you from? Where are you from? Opens and starts discussing the issue. So what was the idea? It was shown in Whitney Biennial in New York, but the critic didn't understand it. He praised it for wrong reason, because he called it an interesting sculpture. It was, in the New York Times, you know, those critics, very often, not usually, but very often, don't know what they are saying, but, you know.
When you're in a situation,
so this kind of equipment.
It's not a flirting machine.
To facilitate flirting for an otherwise introverted person like myself.
Okay, so we don't have time to indulge in each of those projects, but there's this one that we designed when I was at MIT with my interrogative design group. That's how we call our design group. It's specially designed, this is just in the stage of development, so don't worry about this brain being shown. But it's equipment to speak through your own back. It's specifically designed for Japanese high school students, with them, in fact, because with psychologists, school psychologists, and experts on so-called school refusers in Japan, meaning new philosophers, very young people who refuse, go to school and refuse the school. They're not school dropouts. They also refuse the situation at home, because of domestic violence. So they are kind of philosophers. Like when there's any next revolt in Japan, it will be done by high school students, because university is too late. They're already in this kind of labor kind of machine. To let those people to speak hard, because face-to-face communication doesn't work well in Japan. So they themselves actually suggested some ideas. So this here, there are various sketches here. Well, it's actually It has two cameras, the speaker, and monitors in the back, and the microphone here, excuse me, and the speaker there, and also a rear view mirror to see the interlocutor. But some versions also have a camera and monitor here. And there are versions with computer and without. With computer, it allows to pre-record all of those things to fire through your back. I've recorded and edited well and switched to real-time speech as well, so with a little button. So this is the kind of equipment that I think it's important for me to share it with you because of this media environment in which we are here, communicative equipment that is being produced here, and also because it is a very Canadian tradition, media, McLuhan, communications, something that definitely was born here before, actually got more kind of disseminated in across the border. So he came with this to class because he was being bullied because he supposedly has a different texture of his skin. I couldn't see any difference. The microscope, you won't see it. But somehow there is this kind of constant process of finding the stranger, even in a very uniform cultural environment, and then expelled. So he came with this to class. So, sometimes the laughter is very important because it, as Benjamin said, it provides better conditions to start to think, than the vibration of the diaphragm provide better conditions for thinking than vibration of the soul, he said, talking about Brecht. So there's something about this design that is Brechtian. But let me see here. So you see, there's not much happening here.
Yeah.
As always. So the initiative comes from this young person. This is the situation where this young person. Her father left the family without word and not leaving on the word or money, disappeared. So the mother is blaming husband for her father for everything. So she's devastated. So she decided to wear it and go to the cafeteria where lots of men are eating. It's a corporate building. They all look similar to father because people look very similar in those particular institutions. And so she decided to confront the situation reluctantly, very reluctantly. Not sure. But it was her idea. So we had this camera, eventually we moved back and we observed the situation.
あなたはね、じゃあその現象を見てどんなふうに思う？すごく苦しかったですね。ああ。私としては、なんで泣いてたのかなって思って。こんな状態だからそんなことが喋れるよね。はい。面と向かったらね。うん。でもさ、
That's easy to say.
いい恋愛をして、いい旦那を捕まえないとな。ね。頑張って。ありがとうございます。でも、負けないでよ。
So, I will now show some other projects faster, because now we understand basically the method of this type of work. It's developmental work. So each project creates conditions for people to develop their capacity to communicate. And this part I cannot show in my videos presentation. It's done through long process, sometimes 1 year long, sometimes 7 or 6 months long, where people are trying to learn how to use the equipments or projections, because this, what I learned from those equipments, was then I also use for my projections. So the next project I will show was actually a combination of this wearable equipment and projection. So people could now speak through the buildings, through the facades, to be much larger than they are and actually take a position of witness of monuments, of historic structures, take them off or take over them, like hijack them, or animate them with their own life. In this way, let's say, themselves being monuments to their own trauma, their own experience, silent monuments, they can become speaking monuments. But in order to animate those big structures and buildings, they have to animate themselves first. So this kind of animation, it has both psychological dimension and social dimension, cultural dimension, and also political dimension. So in this way, democratic process can be animated by people who otherwise will be silent and from whom we learn nothing. Because they are the ones who are in the very bottom of society and they really see what's wrong. They are the ones who should open up and speak and share their perspective in public space for democracy to actually succeed. They are the ones, they are new paresiastes, you know, those the animators from ancient Greece of which Foucault was speaking, if you are interested in philosophical perspective on this, or contemporary cynics. You know, this philosophical movement that was 500 years long in between before Jesus Christ and after, this cynics like Diogenes, for example, who would really tell the truth and live the truth and speak of stomach, heart, and mind directly what's wrong, disrupt the continuity of things that go on in order to bring very important issues, risking on reputation, life, perhaps, being, of course, stranger himself. Those cynics, ancient cynics, were usually foreigners of foreign breed, you know, and they called themselves dogs. Like Diogenes, the dogs, the ones who are in close to the ground, who smell what's wrong, who know, tactically connected with the terrain, and they speak from the position of dog, right, about the city. So, this is very important. But if one could also speak through huge monument building, well, that might actually be pretty powerful. So one here is a projection on this museum, like a palace of culture in Switzerland, in Basel, Kunstmuseum, where the best works of art are, which usually immigrants have no access But illegal immigrants, the sans-papiers, as they're called, basically are a very difficult situation in Switzerland. As we know, each referendum actually puts, like, makes more and more difficult for them to become citizens. So, I work with this sans-papiers organization. At night, we were recording those people. They come at night, so no one will see them. And they will be projected in such way so their faces won't be recognizable. So they could actually take over this museum, this palace of culture, and speak from the heights of that building the truth of their experience to puzzled kind of local residents. And speaking, of course, German, Swiss German, you know. Because they are, you know, they live there, they're part of the culture. Of course, with Arabic accent, Ukrainian accent, or various accents, but with Swiss German. So, here they are, arriving. In the building. Empty institution. Of course. Christi,
wenn die Leute
Projektor.
Mich fragen oder wollen, du kommst, das finde ich normal. Ich denke, die Leute wollen einfach mich kennenlernen. Das gefällt mir auch. Das finde ich nicht
schlimm. So they speak of various things. They don't have time to show the whole project. What's interesting is that, yes, they are bigger, but this is not the issue, that they are larger. What's the issue is that the public is smaller. That's very important. It means that the public is not in a position to, they know through their own neck, you know, they know that they are smaller, like children, like students who want to learn something from somebody who really is coming to, you know, with some knowledge, some important knowledge about their own country, their own place. So, And this sans-papier, this paper, become the fetish, you know, the document.
So
they resent this
thing. Gute Zukunft haben und die darf er nicht.
Doch, es gibt da nicht die Meinung,
so the paper.
Weil sie ein Schweizer Pass haben. Sind mehr Menschen als andere. Die denken, ja, ich habe einen Schweizer Pass. Die zeigen es eigentlich. Ich bin Schweizer. Und du bist nicht. Nur weil er ein Papier hat, wo draufsteht, du bist Schweizer. Das sagt nicht, dass er ein Schweizer ist. Er muss hier wirklich hier leben.
They're gone. So this situation, it's in El Centro Cultural. This is in Tijuana. Tijuana is a very dynamic city. There's lots of problems. It's on the other side of the border of a pretty sleepy town called San Diego. Tijuana is like, everything is there. But there's also hundreds of factories that are called maquiladora. They are the places where parts are sent from various countries. They are assembled there into products and sent back to the original markets. They're called maquiladora. So, this, you know, this is not happening with Christie projectors, but most of other projectors are assembled there. You know, this the Siemens, you know, and all those big Japanese companies are doing. So there's a cheap labor there that does it. So I work with, so this Le Centro Cultural, which is the kind of important public space there, I offer to those women as a possibility of kind of screen to speak of their experience, and also other people, young people. So we design a special kind of equipment, wearable, you could say it's wearable projection or television station with the camera, lights, and microphone, and could wirelessly be transmitted to projector. Actually, there were two big Christie projectors used there. So no matter what direction the person is looking, the face will be always be perfectly, you know, feeding the facade. There is a relation between face and facade, surface, in etymologically, but that's a different issue. So here you have the equipment. There were two pieces of equipment built at MIT. It's very simple. It's not a high technology. Actually, it's a little spy camera. You know, you can put the gadgets, a little bit like a bricolage. It's not an instrumental research like Media Lab, but in some ways it's a cultural prosthetics, let's call it, made of various components. So there were two of them. One person was using it and animating the facade. Another person was preparing to use it. And meantime, there were also pre-recorded material that was filmed with the use of the same equipment over about 1 year period. You know, with various members of this organization called Factor X. The organization is trying to teach workers their rights. It's founded by a federal government, central government, and it's being attacked by all of those drug lords or the actually drug, the whole, there's a drug war there, but also there are factory owners, and there's lots of troubles there. So it's very difficult to really say, I am going to be the biggest face in the city and be filmed. But at the same time, what I explained when we discussed this project at Christie's, it's not for everybody. It's for people who are ready to make a leap, to jump into cultural project. After years of learning how to survive and maybe get a little better together. This particular, someone says, okay, my husband is going to be released from prison, and I put my husband to prison for incest, and he is saying everybody that all what he wants to do is to kill me. So if that's the case, I better make myself visible. It's much safer being media and newspapers and all that than hiding. And somebody else, you know, I cannot do it because I will lose my job or something. Or so other people, somebody says, okay, I won't be recognized because of distortion of the building. So, because the person is between the building and herself, between facade and face. So this kind of distortion can also be used as a way to say, okay, it's not me, it's a building. Or one say, okay, no, it's me who is as big as the building.
So you guys, black camera is ready to roll.
pasó un mes para que yo me enterara de esto. Y aquí estaba con mi madre en Mazatlán. Regresé a Tijuana. Supo tu experiencia. Y lo incierto.
Nos golpeó también con la cacha de la pistola.
So what is important is to for you to know that this is this El Centro Cultural. It's actually called La Bola, and it contains IMAX theater. So there is a projection inside, and at that time was this propaganda projection called People of the Sun, which was to explain that there's a glorious relationship between people of Mexico and the United States. And, as question was, it was. But anyway, at one point, people from inside of this spectacle joined the public outside, which is interesting.
Mi amiga Wendy era novia de Héctor y se puso como loca, histérica, al ver que nos, bueno, que estaban golpeando a Héctor y nos estaban golpeando a nosotros.
La bola.
Quiso golpear a un policía con las manos, le empezó a golpear. Entonces, bueno, eso fue mucho rato, ¿no? De que lo estuvieron golpeando, a nosotros nos golpearon. Y a ella la subieron a un policía la agarró y la subió a la patrulla. Entonces después se subió el otro, el que iba manejando la patrulla.
This is about police violence, which is a big problem in relation to young people.
Y se fueron. Entonces nosotros pues estábamos, bueno, Rocío y yo estábamos muy nerviosas y vimos a Héctor tirado en el piso todo sangrado.
So this is important because this person decided to speak to her husband, but her husband was trying to escape to the United States, crossing the border, leaving her and children, escaping with his girlfriend. And he was caught. So it's a kind of revenge story. You know, what you've been mistreating me for all of those years, now you got, our accounts are straight, she says. So at the very end, because he's always screaming at her, so she decided to really speak through La Bola the truth.
Cállate. Es la última vez que lo haces. No me vuelvas a gritar. No me vuelves a insultar. Jamás me vuelves a insultar. Es lo último que voy a permitirte. Nunca jamás vuelvas a gritarme. Óyelo bien, nunca jamás.
So, this is important because also realized that this kind of media animation could also take much more of a powerful form if I could use mobile equipment. For example, vehicles, coming back to the vehicles. So I designed here a kind of vehicle for war veterans, which is based on military vehicles, like, for example, Humvee. So they could, the vehicle that usually have a kind of projectile launcher, very often placed in it, to replace this projectile launcher into projection equipment, to really spread the truth of the experience of war veterans, especially after they come back home, and try to at least shake the wall that separates those who know what war is and those who don't, by kind of continuing the war. Because the war happens very far away, but in fact affects lots of families. Each traumatized soldier re-traumatizes here, in the United States I'm talking about right now, but also Poland or Britain, other places where I work, re-traumatizes 7 to 9 people. I'm talking about epidemics of trauma as a result of the war. So to really try to explain impossible thing, that is to transmit experience of being traumatized by war, it's difficult. So it needs extraordinary measures to do this. So I decided to use this technique of vehicles. Like this one.
The ones that aren't giving in, the tougher ones. Living day by day out there, just like out in Iraq or in Vietnam or in Korea.
The first step to me in solving problems of veterans is not making so damn many of them.
What's important is that I started working with homeless veterans. Because in the United States, enormous amount of veterans become homeless. But because of their own condition, they are dehumanized, they are turned into, as they call themselves, jungle animals, in order to be proper soldiers. 80% of them are trained to kill, and they kill. Only 20% were killing during the Second World War. Therefore, they are killing and they witness people being killed and they survived. Enormous amount of people survived because of armor and new technology. So we are receiving enormous amount of alive people rather than in coffins. But they are completely destroyed. And they destroy themselves and others. So that's why they become homeless, because they want to protect their families against themselves, from themselves, or protect themselves from harming people. So they destroy themselves and so forth. So it's a very complicated situation. I think that because of this huge American military force, more than 50% of all of the expenses on military expenses in the world are America, United States. So the incredible machine coming back home. So what I'm trying to say is that cultural projects are needed to also prepare the population for their return, and also psycho-cultural projects to help some of those people to really be able to reconnect with society by telling the truth, rather than being in traumatic silence. So this is, again, the same combination of psychology, politics, aesthetics, and cultural work.
People don't understand what a flashback is. Certain things will bring it out and spoil the day.
That's a Land Rover. That's Liverpool.
The sound and the rhythm I don't like. Slamming doors, slamming windows.
I can't stand crowded places, I can't.
So the public space is the worst place for veterans, because that's where everything happens. Could be snipers, suicide bombers. They are completely displaced because they are overly sensitive and alerted. So they are staying away. Actually, they hide.
So it's always time to move back to the wall, or if I really feel really bad, I'll just move on.
This is Poland. That's Polish strange vehicle, but that's the way they look. So this is important. I don't have subtitles. I will translate what this woman is saying. She's a wife of a veteran. The decision for my husband to go on a mission was like a firing a bullet that wounded my husband and then wounded me, consequently destroying our marriage, killing the family we had only just created, because the person who returned was totally different. A bullet that ricocheted, emotionally ricocheted, which flew out of control, hitting straight into our feelings. So that's what she
said. Wojna w Iraku. Jedziesz na wojnę w Afganistanie. Zastanów się, czy jesteś gotowy na to
pojechać. Also, think about 10 times before you sign up. So this, I will end my presentation with a fragment of projection just happened a year ago in New York City.
Go into the ravines is the first line of attack, and you're going to die, pretty much. So we're sitting
in
the kitchen, and we're talking, and I'm like, okay, you're going to die. And he just looked at me and gave me a look like any teenage kid. I mean, because he was, what, Nicholas was like around 18 and a half. So any teenage kid, oh, you know, you're just blowing, you know, blowing hot air and stuff like that. So we got into a very intense argument. He's like, well, then why would you tell me? I would think that you would understand why I'm joining America, because you were a Marine. And I stopped for a minute because it's true, I wasn't a Marine. So why am I sitting here telling him? I said, because we're at war, you idiot. You figured it. We're at war right now. If you go, you're going to die.
I was going to the bridge with a friend, and it was sunny, and I just felt like I was back in country, back in Iraq, and I felt like I wanted to be on the gun, like I wanted to have the machine gun and just fire. But
so this is the feeling. You can see the monument to Abraham Lincoln
being back there,
being animated by war veterans on occasion of Veterans Day.
The Marine.
It lasted 1 month in New York City, Union Square.
Stuff,
This veteran is a kind of just returning soldier. He barely can move. He's suffering clearly some traumatic condition.
I'm just in Long Island. Nowhere else.
So he's talking about the lack of feelings.
I couldn't express myself to a simple I love you. I would say it back, but the emotion wasn't there. The genuine emotion wasn't there. I still had that armor around my heart, because it was hard for me to explain, you know, how I felt genuinely and who I was and what I've been through.
When all your human senses go into withdrawal, or go into overload, is that when you start smelling the blood. That's when you can distinguish a body, how far it is by the smell of the blood and the raw and the flesh, decomposed flesh. You can smell either one of them from 100 meters. You know where somebody is dead at, just because of the downwind brought the scent over to you. It makes you shake, even without having anything in front of you that makes you scared. It makes you shake. It's horrifying, these dreams.
Cleaning up the blood alone was what I had to do. That was my permanent job of keeping the sanitariness of my aircraft. So, that ended up, it took its point on me, you know? And I just couldn't take it anymore. And I ended up coming home myself on a stretcher.
Wake up, people! Help the veterans. Do something for the veterans.
Thank you.